You know, the Egyptian who was being cruel to a man, Moses fled, but he found out that people knew about that. He fled to Midian. He stayed there 40 years, and he married there a Midianite woman. And then you remember that during that the time that he came back to his people, his father-in-law helped him. He helped him set up the system of delegation. And then later, his brother-in-law came from Midian. But here we see that the Midianites were involved in this with the Moabites in turning the people against God. So God told Moses that he was going to have to defeat the Midianites. This was probably a hard thing, because while these people were not related to the Hebrews as a whole, they were related to Moses, and he spent 40 years of his life with them. And so the people went out to attack them, and when they attacked them, they came back and they said, "We've killed all the men, we've taken that's exactly what happened. He says, "We brought back the women." And Moses says, "What? You brought back the women? Aren't they the ones who got you involved in the temple prostitution and worshiping the Baals? What are you talking about?" And in the laws of holy war, they were to kill all the people. You remember God told them that? Why? Because sin is contagious. They've just seen that. They have just gotten involved with false gods. God said you're to kill them all. So God had them kill everyone. And Moses allowed them only to allow the virgins who had not yet been involved with any man. He allowed them to live. And then you say, "What? What does this have to do with anything?" Well, I guess the idea here is that they were just getting ready to divide up the land among all the 12 tribes that happens toward the end of Numbers and then again in Deuteronomy. And so none of the men were to come and inherit any of the land that was going to be given to the Israelites. It was for them only. So therefore, no women who had sons could come into the land, because then they might think they should inherit some of the land. So only those women who had never been involved with a man could come in. For one thing, they were not the ones involved in temple prostitution, right? Because they were still virgins. And secondly, they had no sons, no children, no husbands who would be involved in the inheritance. And so they took all of their possessions, and the Israelites split them up among them, and then they allowed these aliens to come into the land and to be a part of them. And then throughout the rest of the book, we find out that Moses reviews some of the things he's talked to them about before. You see, he talks about the festivals, and he talks about cities of refuge, remember? And he talks about allocation of land. And remember that with the Levites, all of the people were given land that was going, and we'll find more about that in Deuteronomy. Everybody inherited land, the land belonged to God, that it also was divided among the 12 tribes, and this land was to be theirs in perpetuity. They were always to keep this land in their tribe. And the Levites were the only tribe that was not given any land, because the Levites were the tribe of the priest, and they were to be supported totally by the people, so that they had to do no work outside of their priestly duties. So they didn't have an inheritance. That meant for their entire lives, the entire tribe of Levi was to be taken care of by the people, and they were supported by the tithes which the people gave, which they were obligated to give. In the age of grace, God gives us a choice about whether we choose to tithe. But let me tell you, ladies, when we do give to the Lord as he has blessed us, he gives us far more than we could ever ask four things. He stretches, the book of Hosea talks about the fact that when we give to God, he sews up the holes in our pockets. Because what happens is, those of us who don't give put money in our pockets and it comes out the holes and we lose it. But when you give to God, and when you give out of a cheerful heart, God sews up those holes in your pocket. So that your money goes so much further. We found this early in our marriage, and Ron told you sometimes that when we first got married, although we both came from homes at times, we both knew better. When we first got married, we just don't have any money. We were students. We didn't have any money and we didn't tithe. And that didn't last very long because God showed us something very important. We were in seminary. We lived in this roach-infested apartment, and next door to us had some people from Africa had moved in, and they had a whole huge family, I think 11 people, living in this apartment, and their kitchen backed up to our kitchen. Every time I opened any of my cabinet doors, I saw just a horrible place. Anyway, that's where we lived. And we bought when our friends moved out of that apartment next door to it. We bought their washing machine for $10. And we used it for about maybe 6 weeks and it broke. Oh, no. And so we called out the Sears man to come and look at the washing machine. He showed Ron how to pull the belt a few more times. He said, if you do this, you'll be able to use this washing machine a few more times. Of course, we're broke. We're students. And so Ron, every time I got ready to wash, he pulled the belt a few more times. And then do you know what happened? The belt caught on. And when we left seminary 4 years later, we still had the washing machine. We still used it, so we took it to West Virginia with us. We used it 2 years in West Virginia. We got ready to leave West Virginia and move back to Birmingham to Ron's home church. So we took the washing machine with us, and the washing machine lasted 5.5 more years. We were getting ready to move to Canada, and we said, you know what? This washing machine has given us good service. I don't think we'll take it any further. It's a long way from Alabama to Canada. We won't take it. God made that washing machine last all of those years. And I will believe till the day I die, it was because God sewed up the holes in our pockets. And God said, if you give to me, I'll take care of you. I'll make your stuff last longer. I'll supply your needs in every way possible. And we learned that lesson and we have never forgotten it. And we have always said that through all of our years in the ministry, that one of the reasons God has blessed us so abundantly is because he taught us that lesson very early in our marriage, that we give back to God. And when we give to him, he said, I can do better than this. And he gives you so much more. So ladies, put it to the test. He says in Malachi, I'll open the windows of heaven, I'll pour out so much blessing, there won't be room enough to receive it. And that's all in the context of giving tithes to him. Try it. You'll like it. I can say, I promise you on this, because it's a promise of Scripture. Anyway, that was an aside. But he did talk about the tithes because all of the people were going, the Levites were supported entirely by tithes. And then you also notice the different judicial type systems, the cities of refuge. The Levites were given 48 cities. There were also 6 cities of refuge. And these cities of refuge, it was a unique concept. Anyone who had been involved in any kind of murder, until their case came up in court, they could go to one of these cities of refuge and no one could harm them while they were in the city of refuge. And then when their case came up in court, they would go to court, and if they were found, it was found that it was a premeditated murder, then always capital punishment was in place. That was given in Genesis 9, right after Noah got out of the ark. So if it was premeditated, punishment. If it was an accident, then there would not have a punishment involved, and then they would be given whatever punishment the judge decided. Anyway, that was an interesting judicial concept back in those days, that God protected those people until they had their trial. And then, babies become, they number the people again. Why do they have to number again? We talked about that. They had to number them again because they had a new generation of people. We come to the end of the 40 years, and now those who were 20 and younger are the ones who are now over 20, and they are now the fighting force as they go into their new land. They have to know how big their army is, so that's why they have a new census at the end of the book of Numbers. And as we come to the end of the book of Numbers, Moses is, they are on the east side of the Jordan River, and we have come to the end of the narrative of the Pentateuch at this point. Moses appoints a new leader, Joshua, one of the two spies who came back with a good report, and God says that Joshua is the one who will cross the Jordan and lead the conquest into the new land that he is giving them, and Moses is almost ready to lead his people, and the book of Deuteronomy is Moses' final sermons to his people before he leaves. And he has to tell them, it's a repetition of what's gone before, it would be a good time for us to review, because there's a whole new generation of people. These people were young, they were teenagers, they were young babies, or they weren't even born. And now, all of a sudden, they're the ones who are going to go into the new land. And so Moses gives them final instruction in the book of Deuteronomy, before he too goes to his people. As we close today, I want you just to think about how God used Moses in these absolutely amazing, wonderful ways in the fourth quarter of his life. We start the action with Moses, primarily the action in Exodus, when Moses was 80 years old. Many of us are not there yet, but we're approaching. We are all in the fourth quarter of our lives, nearly every one of us here. And I want you to actually look at the life of Moses to see, oh, God has a job for me. He's not finished with me yet, and he wants to use me, and he has wonderful, special things for me to do, and let me tell you, I don't want to miss those things, because I can tell you again with certainty that God has something special for every single one of us in this room to be used by him if we will allow him. I talked just before I came in this morning, I was on the phone when I got out of the car to Marlon, a friend in Colorado, and you know, the few who know her know that very late in her life she had a spiritual turnaround, and she started going to the jail, and as she went to the jail ministering to those ladies, God did an amazing work in Marlon's life. Well, now she and her husband are in a home assisted living type place, and they are in Colorado near their family, and Marlon told her that they've asked her to do devotionals in the morning. And one morning a week. And then she said there's a devotional at night that they just asked her if she could do. And Marlon's in terrible health. But this is what God has for her in the fourth quarter of his life, of her life. And she's listening and she's doing. And God is blessing. And I'm telling you, ladies, he has the same thing for each of us if we're listening, if our eyes are open, if we're looking, listening, willing to do what God has for us. Now, you all know how much I love Corrie Ten Boom, as I told you before. And as I close today, I just want to read you something briefly from one of her books. It's called The Letters from prison letters that she wrote in Washington prison. As you know, she was a Dutch lady, and she sheltered Jewish people during the time of the occupation in Holland. And her family was all caught. They were sent to prison. Her father and her sister died in prison, and she was released by a clerical error. Anyway, this is not part of her letters. This is simply at the end of the book where she adds an afterword, and I want to read it to you because I think it's so amazing, because God used her in the fourth quarter of her life. Like Moses, it was a very unwilling situation. She didn't want to go to prison. It was a very, very difficult time for her, but God, those of you who know anything about it, know that God used her in an absolutely amazing and wonderful way, just the way he wants to use us. So listen. Hans Roms was one of the ones of people who stood out to her during her time in prison. Let me tell you. Hans Roms was an official in the, I can't pronounce this word, Schedeningen, something like that. It was a prison that was in Harlem, the jail that was in Harlem where she lived. When I was in Montreal, there was a little Dutch woman, and she had known Corrie ten Boom. And so I talked to her, and I asked her how to pronounce this word, and she told me about 12 times how to pronounce it, and I finally gave up because I could not understand with her Dutch accent what she was saying. So anyway, I'm going to skip the word. Hans Roms was an official in his prison during Dutchess and my interrogation. He was instrumental in helping my brother Willem be freed from the jail after only a short stay. Willem was originally arrested with us at the Bahay for teaching a Bible study. But while we were in prison, that the Lord touched Mr. Rom's heart so that Etsy and I were both able to tell him about Jesus and his love. Later, in the camp at Bullock, Betsy told me that she had been able to say, "Mr. Roms, it's important to talk about Jesus, but it's more important to talk with him. Would you mind if I prayed with you?" 5 times, she was ordered to report to this man for interrogation, and 5 times she prayed with him. She, the prisoner, and he, her judge. Through this, Hans Roms became a friend instead of an enemy, and we were recipients of his help several times during our imprisonment. One morning, just before hearing, he showed the papers to me. When I saw them, I knew that many lives were in great danger, for the papers contained detailed information about my underground activities. I could see on them the name of friends, co-workers, underground workers, Jews. When he asked me to explain the papers, I could not. The silence that followed was one of the most agonizing moments of my life. Then, suddenly, that moment was transformed into joy, for the judge took all the papers, opened the stove door, and threw them in the fire. Before my eyes, I saw the flames destroying every name, and at that instant, I understood the verse in Colossians 2:14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. That's what Christ did for us and for me. After the war, I had the privilege of meeting Hans Roms several times, and he once said, "Corrie, I shall never forget your sister's prayers." There were many things for which I needed to thank Mr. Roms, for it was he who helped free my friends and some of my family from prison. Because he did many good deeds for people, it was difficult for him to see that he needed a Savior. But during one of our later meetings, he saw that he was a sinner and that he needed Jesus. Together, we had experienced many dark moments and occasionally a light. But the moment he accepted the Lord Jesus was one of life's richest experiences for me. For on that day, I glimpsed a little of God's side of the pattern of my life. God had only plans, no problems, in the life of Ladies, that was in the fourth quarter of her life. God wants to use you. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word and what it teaches about you, but it teaches us about ourselves. And Lord, we long for you to forgive us and to use us. So Lord, today, on behalf of all of these women, I commit us to you for your service, for you to use us in amazing ways that only you know the plan at this point. But we pray that you would show it to us and that we will commit to serving and following you every day of the rest of our lives. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
I just got word that Cliff did not have a heart attack. The baby will be admitted to the hospital for further testing, but it's not a heart attack.